thank you all for coming, and thank you for the invitation. I'm here to discuss the Iran's democratic opposition movement and group, and I want to begin by sort of commenting on how this particular topic has a particular inflection and resonance in Washington, D.C. As some of you know, there's an emerging debate here in Washington about the question of Iran's democratic opposition group. And the group that's often cited in the vote, and not hear a lot of noise, is this group known as the MEK, the Mujahideen al-Khalq organization. There's a debate ensuing that very soon the Secretary of State Clinton will make a ruling as to whether to take MEK off the U.S. foreign terrorist organization list. Speaking of bipartisanism on both sides of the political divide, you have a number of prominent people, Howard Dean, Lee Hamilton, Lee Giuliani, Louis Free, General Hugh Shelton, et cetera, who have been gotten involved in this debate about the running Democratic opposition. Huge sum of money have been sort of passed around, a lot of press coverage. I suspect some of you are aware of the topic. But what I find so interesting and disturbing about this debate is that it seems that when it comes to the topic of Iran's democratic opposition, we are living in two parallel universes. There is, unfortunately, the universe inhabited by some people who are involved in this debate here in Washington, D.C., with very strong views, who are influenced by political lobby groups, and who have an opinion on the question of Iran's democratic opposition. And then there is the real world, where the rest of humanity lies, where Iran is located, where its people exist, and where I think U.S. foreign policy should be directed. And so in this first world, what I call the fantasy world, a small group of people have sort of are trying to not only turn Iranian politics upside down, but also inside out. And they're trying to claim that this group, the MEK, deserves support, recognition, delisting from the terrorist list, etc. I find all of this a complete inversion of reality. And I'm totally amazed and stunned by it, and how political logic has come up to create a reality unto themselves that's so disconnected from the real world in which we live. The MEK has zero support in Iran. It's an extremist cult. There's really no debate. There's a lot of issues in the Middle East politics where there's room for disagreement. This is actually one issue. There's zero disagreement. There's actually complete consensus, unanimity on this question. And so I think, to the extent that you're interested in that debate, I think it's a complete waste of time. It doesn't advance U.S. interests. It doesn't teach us anything about Iran. What I want to do today is talk about the real world. The real world with respect to Iranian politics. And so, I want to speak about the fact that Iran does have a legitimate, grassroots, authentic, popular, democratic opposition group that is posing huge challenges to the Islamic Republic of Iran. Sadly, they get no recognition here in the West, particularly at the levels of political power here in Washington. I'm speaking specifically about Iran's Green Democratic Opposition Movement, in Farsi, Jombesh-e-Sadat, which emerged after the 2009 fraudulent stolen presidential election in Iran, and which, according to one of the senior commanders of Iran's Revolutionary Guard Corps, the emergence of this group posed a greater threat to the stability of the Islamic Republic of Iran than Saddam Hussein's invasion of Iran in 1980 and subsequent eight-year Iran-Iraq war. And I want to, again, shamelessly here plug a book that I've just edited on the topic, The Fires Outside. It's called The People We Love, The Green Movement, and the Struggle for Iran's Future. Get it for about $10 on Amazon. And I want to briefly go over just what this movement is about. Who is the Green Movement? How did it emerge? What is the basic political platform? How much social support does it have within Iran? And what is their strategy for democratizing Iranian society? So to begin with, the Green Movement is Iran's democratic opposition movement. It's a large umbrella organization. It encompasses different opinions, points of view. Some are more radical, some are more moderate. There is a secular religious sort of components to the broad Green Movement organization. Young people, old people, those in the middle. Its base of support is located primarily in Iran's sizable middle class, about 50% of the population. Young people who comprise two-thirds of Iran's population, strongly supported intellectuals, civil society groups, university students, writers, artisans, women's groups, and including, and this is really important to Green Movement stages protests in Iran for about 6 months. And it's very powerful, and the regime is really shaken by these series of developments. And this Green Movement has gone through three phases. The early phase, from the election in June 2009 till February 2010, is the first phase of the movement. Street protests, people really calling for a reconsideration of the electoral results. The key slogan at the time was, "Where is my vote?" These protests are actually spontaneous. They're not organized by anyone. They're organized by young people, grassroots, using internet, Facebook, and they try to sort of subvert officially nationally staged elections that the regime sort of has on a regular basis to demonstrate its support to the rest of the to the rest of the world. And Green Movement support them, go into the streets and subvert these street demonstrations by chanting their own slogans. And this lasts for a good 6 months. The regime is sort of completely unable to control these demonstrations. And then in January, the regime comes to the end. It starts to engage in a series of targeted assassinations. The nephew of the Supreme Leader all of a sudden is assassinated. A university professor in Tehran is assassinated. Leading figures of the regime come before the nation and publicly call for the execution of protesters. And in the lead up to the anniversary of the Iranian Revolution in February 2010, the regime effectively is able to snuff out the movement, crush it, a lot of human rights violations, abuses, arrests. Nothing as bad as we've seen in Syria, for example. But still, by Iranian standards, hundreds of people are killed, and that figure, that person who sort of got international recognition, this woman by the name of Neda Al-Sultan, sort of embodiment of that protest movement. Second phase emerges from February 2010 right until the beginning of the Arab Spring. It's a phase of reconsideration, re-examination, reformulation, and an attempt by leadership to sort of articulate some core demands for its future of Iran. And so what the leaders of the Green Movement do is they actually put together a political platform. They do a series of speeches, documents are released, interviews that lay out the basic principle vision of this movement. And the most important document is the official charter of the Green Movement, which is appears in the book that I just edited. And it lays out the basic foundations of the movement. Then the Arab Spring emerges. Again, shocks everyone, and it has a resonance in Iran. After the overthrow of Mubarak, the Green Movement leaders call for a solidarity rally on February 14th of this year, in solidarity with Tunisia and with Egypt, to support the Arab Spring. But of course, really the intention was at home, but the official excuse is solidarity with Egypt and Tunisia, and the Green Movement leaders call for a public protest, and tens of thousands of people come into the streets, and the regime is shocked by this. Because up until now, the official line of the regime after the protests following the presidential election is that there is no Green Movement. It's crushed. These are people manipulated by the CIA, receiving money from the Saudis. They have no public base of support. But lo and behold, the Green Movement leaders call for public demonstrations. And throughout the cities in Iran, tens of thousands of people show up, and the regime is shocked. And there was one event that was broadcast around the world where Iran's hardline parliament, in Iran's hardline parliament, in the immediate aftermath of these street protests, about 100 members of parliament from the extreme right of Iran's political spectrum gather around the podium of the Speaker of Parliament, and they publicly start chanting for the execution of the Green Movement leaders. It was almost like a meaningful sort of, a scene from some sort of event in the deep annals of history where they were calling for the public executions and the hanging of the Green Movement leaders. I think that was really an indication of how the regime was deeply shocked and embarrassed by its official line of argument and having that exposed on the streets of Tehran. And immediately there's another crackdown, people were arrested, and the Green Movement leaders are effectively taken hostage. And they are placed under house arrest. The regime doesn't announce that they have arrested the Green Movement leaders because it knows that doing so would lead to given this book, which is in translation in Persian, sells out in the streets of Tehran. You can't find any copies. And that, I think, tells us two things. How popular the Green Movement leaders are, and how sophisticated Iranian culture is. Who would think that the Green Movement leader, Mir Hossein Mousavi, would have read, you know, Gabriel Garcia Marquez, Nobel Prize laureate, Latin American author. But that book sort of becomes, recently, sort of a bestseller in Iran because of this particular connection to the fight of the Green Movement leaders in the broader struggle for democracy in Iran. In terms of what the Green Movement actually stands for, let me just read a few excerpts from the charter of the Green Movement. That gives you a sense of what this movement actually is about, where is it, where we've been situated. This is the official founding document of Iran's mainstream opposition movement. Based on the commitment of the Green Movement to basic principles and fundamental human freedoms, the Green Movement considers itself to be a purifier and reformer of the course taken in the Islamic Republic after the 79 revolution. Therefore, it focuses its efforts on the framework of the existing constitution to ensure the respect for people's votes and their opinions. The Green Movement is an extension of the Iranian people's quest for freedom, justice, and national sovereignty, which had previously manifested itself in the 1906 Constitutional Revolution, the 1951 Oil Nationalization Movement, and the 1979 Islamic Revolution. The Green Movement is a broad social movement that does not consider itself infallible. It rejects blasphemous absolutism and stresses the importance of criticism and dialogue, both inside and outside the movement. Overseeing the course and evolution of the movement is essential for political activists, as well as intellectuals and thinkers. This will prevent a slide toward totalitarianism and corruption in our movement. According to Green Movement activists, the people of Iran want to be part of a proud, honorable, and developed country. The Green Movement supports pluralism and opposes all attempts to monopolize. Therefore, we do not tolerate animosity or maliciousness directed against social group. All individuals who consider themselves part of the Green Movement have a responsibility to try to engage in dialogue within a healthy atmosphere with those who are against the movement in order to make them aware of its goals and principles. We are all Iranians, and Iran belongs to all of us. The Green Movement strongly insists on the importance of protecting our country's independence and draws a line at any involvement in foreign forces in our country. However, it does not seek isolation from or animosity towards other countries, and it is not captive to prejudicial tendencies regarding Iranian foreign policy. Justice, freedom, independence, human dignity, and spirituality are all universal values. Among the tasks of the Green Movement is to learn from the experience of nations that have tried to attain these values, and it welcomes the views and criticisms of all freedom-seeking and peace-loving individuals who seek human dignity and freedom. The Green Movement insists on the continued presence of a compassionate religion characterized by forgiveness, spirituality, morality, and the appreciation of human dignity. Furthermore, it points out that emphasizing the ethical and compassionate aspects of Islam and the Islamic Republic is the only way to strengthen religious values. The fundamental principles of the Green Movement should take into account our national religious legacy and the desire for development and progress. And we should steer clear of coercing people into an ideology sect or clique. All people should oppose the use of religion for political instrumental reasons, should protect the religious institutions, and it should call for the separation of the state from religion. And finally, we should maintain and develop the continued importance of religion properly understood in our society. There's a long section here about the importance of human rights, of dialogue, of peace, of nonviolence. But fundamentally, the Green Movement, and this is important in terms of sort of getting a sense of their strategy, the Green Movement, according to their own words, believes in implementing the constitution of the Islamic Republic of Iran in its entirety. That is, in its own words, the main fundamental strategy of the Green Movement. The movement believes that overcoming the crisis that we are facing today and pursuing the development and progress of our nation can only be possible through returning to the law and enforcing its implementation in all institutions, and punishing those who do not abide by it, whatever position they may hold, whatever position they may government to override the democratic aspirations of their own citizens. So that strategy of working within the Constitution is deeply controversial. There are very powerful arguments as to why the Green Movement insists on this path. And we can talk about it. Whether it will actually work or not is a different sort of argument. So the Green Movement, in other words, the strategy is not revolutionary. It's reform. One reason why it's not revolutionary is because there's no appetite any longer for a revolution. Unlike in the Arab world, where there is a lot of appetite. The main reason being is that Iran had a revolution about 32 years ago. It was a very bitter experience. When you talk about revolution, people associated with the revolution and the chaos and the uncertainty and the economic turmoil Iran experienced in the first decade after 1979. They also experienced revolution with the very destructive legacies of what they've seen in two countries on their borders, Iraq and Afghanistan. People are fearful of that, the chaos and anarchy coming into their country, but they're very much in favor of, very hungry for, and desirous of a serious qualitative structural reform. So I would describe the Green Movement, quoting from the words of one Columbia University professor who's in our book. He describes the Green Movement, I think, right accurately and effectively as a civil rights movement. Similar to the civil rights movement that we had here in this country in the 60s, it accepts the basic framework of the law, tries to reform it, to democratize it, elevate the rights of those who've been disadvantaged by the existing structure of power. In terms of the strategy, though, of the Green Movement, I want to quote from one young scholar who's written that while it may be an exaggeration to say that the decentralized Green Movement has a single strategy, the approach of the Green Movement's top leaders suggests that their hopes lie in exploiting the gray zones of Iranian politics through a strategy of patience and endurance. The Green Movement already enjoys support of millions of restless young men and women across the political spectrum, who hope and desire for serious and radical change. But the leadership of the Green Movement, Amir Hossein Mousavi and other top leaders, are fixated on what they refer to as the gray area, made up of religious associations and traditional factions that do not quite support the Green Movement, but are quite unhappy with the existing status quo in Iran, and particularly the policies of Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. By pledging unconditional loyalty to the foundations of the Islamic Republic, the leaders of the Green Movement ought to attract, or at least to neutralize, these moderate conservatives and many influential figures in various religious and political circles. This strategy rests on the ability of the Green Movement to broaden its appeal into those conservative gray zones. It has already created an unprecedented gap within the conservative establishment, capitalizing on their impeccable revolutionary credentials, the leaders of the Green Movement have striven to push the fault line as deep as possible into the conservative camp so that when the next crisis hits, they can draw deeper on society for support, particularly from that segment of Iranian society that remains loyal to the regime. And that's another element. If you want to understand Iran, you can't look at Mubarak's Egypt, Ben Ali's Tunisia. Iran has its own unique history and dynamic and power balance. And if you ask me, I think there is a segment of Iranian society, about 15 to 20%. At its heyday, I think those numbers have decreased, but about 15 to 20% of Iran's population supports the political status quo in Iran, supports the Islamic Republic, believes that the Supreme Leader does have some holy divine authority. And that's a reality that you can't ignore when it comes to the question of democracy. The regime can draw upon these people for support. Some of these people buy into the regime, believe it for ideological reasons, because they really believe that this regime is the embodiment of Islamic authenticity. Others, like any authoritarian regime, support the system because their careers, their livelihood, their financial destiny is tied up with the existing political order. So 15-20% of the regime, of the population, I think, is sympathetic and more supportive of the regime, and they are willing to come to the streets, they're willing to break heads, they are willing to fight and die for the regime. That's a reality that can't be ignored when it comes to democratizing Iran. You can't pretend that you can just sort of launch a military strike, take out the supreme leader, and then, you know, revolution, then democracy will break up the next day. So the leaders of the Green Movement, I think, are cognizant of this fact, and that's why conservative hardline factional battle between supporters of the Supreme, Supreme Leader in Iran and those of the president, Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. This chaos, the corruption, the existing bank scandal has really shaken the confidence of Iranians, not all Iranians, particularly those Iranians who are supportive of the regime, conservative-minded, religiously devout. They're watching this squabble and they're very confused and baffled. It's very hard to sort of look at the current establishment and think that these are noble, righteous people pursuing the best national interest when it's one scandal after the next. There's a lot more to say on this topic, but let me just sort of end, because I want to leave time for some questions and answers, you know, we're all watching the Arab Spring, and I think the recent developments in the region are a very positive turn in terms of the prospects for democracy in Iran. Why? Because the political and moral landscape in the Middle East has changed dramatically over the last year. The focus now, the international focus with respect to the region, is on the theme of democracy. The global spotlight is now being directed toward authoritarian regimes, dictatorial regimes, and at the same time, a global spotlight is elevating the voice of opposition democratic movements. The Iranian regime has been very worried and disturbed by the Arab Spring. It's projecting sort of this confident position, proclaiming and celebrating these revolutions when they broke out in Tunisia and then in Egypt. But it's in this ironic and very sort of difficult position where it's praising these democratic revolts in the Arab world while cracking down on the precise movements within their own country. And then when it comes to Syria, they're completely silent, clandestinely behind the scenes, supporting the Syrian regime, and very worried about what may happen in the case of Syria should Bashar Assad fall. So I think this regional transformation has got the regime very shaken. It's also inspired the pro-democracy movement in Iran, as we saw in February when they had these demonstrations. Then there was a crackdown. And I think what awaits Iran is an opportunity, another moment of crisis for the movement to reassert itself. One of the problems of the movement is simply sort of street demonstrations not going to bring down the regime. There has to be some sort of change in calculus. But the fundamental, I think, preconditions for democratic transition in Iran look very good. And if Iran actually does make a democratic transition, you're not going to see the same type of divisive debates that we are seeing now, or beginning to see in the Arab world, with respect to the question of religion and state, the role of Sharia law in politics. Iran has gone through an important intellectual transformation over the last 30 years. The battle for ideas, I'm prepared to argue, is essentially over in Iran. It's been won by the Green Movement and by the democratic forces. And the regime in Iran knows this because it spends, one indication of this is that, you know, the regime spends, the Iran regime spends a lot of money and energy on trying to block access to information, jamming satellite television, particularly the BBC Persian network, jamming the Voice of America, particularly this new show that may have heard of it, it's getting a lot of good coverage recently. It comes out of the Voice of America. It's basically the Iranian equivalent of the Daily Show by Jon Stewart. Massively popular, using sort of comedy to sort of engage in satire, provide really deep and penetrating and powerful critiques of the political status quo in Iran. Very popular among young people. Everyone sort of is talking about this. And the regime sort of is really paranoid. It knows it's lost the battle for ideas. Another indication that the battle for ideas is really over in Iran is look at the number of journalists and intellectuals that this regime has imprisoned. Intellectuals and journalists deal with the question of ideas. The regime cannot win a public debate over the question of the human rights record, over the record of its, you know, last 30 years of the Islamic Republic. So it has to sort of enforce this sort of very repressive climate, fearful that if people actually do have the opportunity to debate ideas and vote freely, they will vote for democratic candidates, and this regime cannot win any public debate or referendum on its track record. The one nightmare scenario that I think would set all of this back would be a foreign military strike on Iran. In fact, I'm prepared to argue that there are elements within the Iranian regime that actually welcome an external military strike. Because then they can say, see, we told you so. Our number one issue should be external aggression, imperialism coming from the West. We don't need a free press, we don't need a democratic parliament, we don't need these sort of these divisive debates about human rights and democracy. We need to rally around the flag from the external aggressor that's about to attack us. And if that does happen, I'm prepared to argue that, you know, the regime will use that opportunity to arrest thousands, execute hundreds, if not thousands of people, and really sort of and this internal crisis of democracy that it's facing. So the last comment here is really that I think the achievements of the Green Movement over the last 2 years, and it's still a very young movement, have been deeply impressive. It has fractured the Iranian regime at the senior elite level. It's won the intellectual argument regarding the future of Iran and its democratic direction, and it has attracted large segments of society toward its position. But it's important to stress that there's no guarantee that the Green Movement will succeed next year or in the next decade. I mean, it's an open question. I think the Islamic Republic is deeply steadily heading toward history's junkyard. That's inevitable. It's living on borrowed time. But the future of Iran, I think, very much is still subject to contestation and to struggle. And the series of decisions that are made by the United States and its allies today will help condition the contours of power in tomorrow's Iran. And so the role of the international community, particularly with respect to Iranian politics, is deeply important, particularly given the very troubled relationship that Iran has had with the West over the last 150 years, and particularly given the very troubled relationship that Iran has had with the United States since the 1953 coup d'etat. So U.S. policy here, I think, has a very important role to play, and if properly designed and crafted, can play an important role in promoting democratic transition in Iran. If that does take place, you will see a new Iran, a new foreign policy that I think will completely change the way we think about the contemporary Middle East. So thanks for your time. We've got time for 20 minutes of questions.
Well, with that tour de force of the internal dynamics, politics, and so forth of Iran, here's your chance to just pepper in some questions. That was a very excellent presentation. Very, very informative. So here's your chance.
Sure. Thanks for coming, Professor. It's a little bit of a journey from out west. So, you know, you described the Green Movement as more democratic, but couldn't one make the argument, I mean, the Islamic Republic has been quite democratic. It's held elections ever since 1980, so it's had 30-plus years of elections. I mean, we can take issue with this last election, the fraudulence of it, and so forth, but I think an argument could be made that it has been democratic. And if we're talking about reforms, it's a reform movement. I think the major issue the United States has, obviously, with its ally Israel, is the nuclear issue.
Right.
Now, Iran made the decision long ago to pursue nuclear weapons, or at least nuclear capabilities that can be flipped on like a switch. So, given that in mind, what foreign policy do you see that the Green Movement would pursue? Would they just say, guys, this whole nuclear business is behind us. You know, we're done with that. Because when Khatami was, it was the same policy. So, I mean, nothing much has changed on this score, at least from my analysis.
A big question. A Green Movement foreign policy with respect to the nuclear question will be both similar and different than what we see today. Different in the following sense, that I think the Green Movement leadership would want to at a very core level reduce international tensions.
Sure.
It will want to work with the international community to sort of have inspections, but at the same time, it does not want to give up its right to pursue its own nuclear program, because this is one thing that all Iranians share, and this is one thing all Iranians share across the political spectrum, and the regime in Iran has been very successful in doing that. It's taken this nuclear question that the West insists on, and it's turned into national.
Yes, nuclear nationalism.
And they're saying, look, you know, here we are, great powers are dictating us how we're going to develop our own energy program. So the Green Movement cannot, even if it wanted to, go against that popular sentiment. So it believes in the right for Iran to develop. But at the same time, the Green Movement's foreign policy, and it hasn't really articulated any clear document. I mean, there's sort of references to, right, we want to have a good relationship with everyone. But it knows that we've got the details we need to visit. But if you listen to what they say, if you talk to Green Movement leaders, they are very, and this is something all Iranians share, particularly in the middle class, particularly young people, Iranians across the spectrum are deeply embarrassed by the fact that they are ostracized from the international that Ahmadinejad gets up and makes speeches. They're very embarrassing to people. They want to be integrated, but at the same time, they don't want to turn their country into a vassal state. They want to be, proud, they want to be dignified, they want to say that, look, we have a role to play here. So I think you want to get a sense of what Iranian foreign policy would be like under the Green Movement. This might be disturbing to some, but I think it's an accurate parallel. It will be something very similar to what you see in contemporary Turkey. It will be, in fact, I think, reduce tensions and not make this into such a cause for isolation and concern. I think that's the way things will go. But they're not going to do what I think many people in the United States want them to do, and what we saw recently in the case of Gaddafi in Libya, where you just give it up.
Exactly.
Not on that point, by the way. You know, after Gaddafi gave up his nuclear weapons and after the uprising in Libya, there was a very famous statement that Iran's Supreme Leader made. You know, and he basically said to Gaddafi, you know, summarizing, "You stupid idiot. Why did you give up these nuclear weapons? Look what happened." And he said, "Look, the lessons here for us are very clear." So I think, you know, with respect to Iran being a democracy, look, those elections, yes, Iran's had existing elections. But they've never been free elections. They've been fair elections in the sense that when you cast the vote at the ballot box, the announced result reflects those, except the 2009 election, which was stolen. But those elections have never been, they've always been subject to ideological screening, even more so going forward. There was a moment in 97, late 97, talking this first period where, you know, they were much more open because of public pressure. So the elections have never been free. They've been basically fair. But I think, you know, in a democratic Iran, we're going to have people from different perspectives.
So they would, they
run
would
the office.
So you're essentially making the point that they would end
That's actually one of the explicit
vetting process.
One of the explicit statements of the agreement, just to sort of
isn't that in the Constitution?
Well, no, it's not. It's sort of been reinterpreted. But, you know, Iran is going to face another crisis moment, mark my words. Next February, we're going to have parliamentary elections.
Yeah.
The regime uses these moments of national elections, parliament and president, to send a message to the world. Look how much popular support we have. Look how many people have come to vote for us. But what are they going to do in March when you're going to have a huge, massive boycott of the election? Because the last one, 2 years ago, was a fraudulent one. No one has any faith in elections anymore. Then you can see the messages being sent right now. The regime wants the reform movement, the Green Movement, to participate in the elections, but the Green Movement has drawn a line, and they'll stick to it and a little further. They're saying, look, we're not going to participate in these elections unless three conditions are met. One, all political prisoners have to be free. Two, freedom of political parties and a free press so you can have a meaningful election. And three, a real election without these scanning of candidates and this advisory board that sort of screens people for ideological purity. So the regime is facing a crisis. There's no predicting. I mean, one of the lessons of the Arab Spring here is no one can predict when these things would break out. No one predicted that there would be demonstrations after the last election anymore. But the level of discontent is deep. The regime knows it. It can't win. It's lost the battle of ideas, and it's trying to just manufacture and play up foreign threats in order to divert attention from what Iranians are sort of facing, but you know, it's really lost the game, so that's why I say the regime is really losing a lot of time.
Could I tail in another question? I mean, given what Saudi Arabia's went through, you know, with Nayef coming in, you know, becoming the crown prince now, so I mean, it raises the idea of secession, and Iran is going to face this at some point very soon, because Khamenei's not a, you know, sprightly young man. I mean, his days are numbered too, as far as health-wise. So I think that is actually going to be a critical point in perhaps changing the constellation of the leadership and the clerical establishment. So I know you're not a prophet, but you are at a pulpit. So let's
I'll give my best guess. I'll sort of go as far as saying that you're absolutely right. Because the Iranian political system and the constitution is so centralized around the figure of the supreme leader, when he passes away, when he dies, it's going to be another huge moment of crisis for the regime. Who are you going to replace? When he came to power, you know, 8 years after the revolution, right after Khomeini, the regime had a lot of support. It was right after the Iran-Iraq war. No one was able to put his head. Now this supreme leader has been in power for 20 years. He's basically, I mean, the slogan that was sort of shouted on the streets of Tehran in February of this year in solidarity with the Arab Spring was Ben Ali, Mubarak Ben Ali announced the term of Sayyid Ali Khamenei. Actually, Iran's better in Persian. But the point is that he's become this sort of, you know, figure of hatred that people have. And so when he's gone, when he dies, who's going to replace him? There's no one figure that has any broader consensus or support. The other person we thought that could be would be Hashemi Rafsanjani. If you know Iranian politics, he's sort of very much sort of leaning toward the opposition and is sort of isolated from the current establishment. So that's going to be another moment of crisis that the regime is going to have to really sort of struggle with. And I think they don't know what to do. I think that would be another moment for the regime to manifest itself and say, okay, look, you know, game over. Now we have to move in a different direction. So I think, yeah, it's something that the regime is going to be, it's going to shake the regime to its core. Yeah.
So the recent admission that sanctions are actually starting
Well, you know, that's a good question. My own reading of it is that these international sanctions, broadly speaking, and we see this in other countries, over time they tend to sort of really impoverish the middle class, the civil society. And so the regime actually uses these sanctions and saying, look, we're being quarantined for this nuclear program. No one's saying anything about Pakistan's nuclear weapons or Israel's nuclear weapons. So the regime is actually turning this economic crisis to its own advantage. We are victims here. And so I think what happens is that these sanctions, really, in my view, if you want to be honest, these are sanctions that are meant to satisfy domestic public opinion and political lobbyists here in the United States. They do not affect, and in fact, I would argue, they undermine the struggle and the transition for democracy in Iran. And that's why the Green Movement is very critical of these broad-based sanctions. Now, having said that, there are sanctions that the Green Movement supports. They may not say so publicly, but I know private conversation they're very in favor of. Those targeted sanctions that are directed toward key members of the regime who are involved in political oppression, financial sort of embezzlement and scandal, and whose bank accounts have been frozen, and their passport, you know, if they travel abroad. Those types of targeted sanctions are not only the Green Movement, but the population on broad support. So this is the problem with these sanctions, you know. They are meant to sort of respond to this moment. Oh, if you want to develop nuclear programs, we have a bomb. What are you going to do? Well, they sanction them, sanction them, sanction them. But the effect that they're having in Iran, broadly speaking, are corrosive. They are undermining the middle class. They're undermining civil society. And they're undermining the struggle for democracy. That's why, in this op-ed that I just wrote, published soon, I speak to this question directly. And you have to admit that U.S. foreign policy toward Iran has failed. There's no distinction now between Obama's policy toward Iran and Bush policy toward Iran. And let's be honest, Iran has been sanctioned by the West for 30 years. Okay, has that qualitatively changed in any significant way regarding foreign policy? It hasn't. So I think we need to have a very serious conversation, a very sort of deep, introspective sort of debate here about a new foreign policy that will actually lead to those transformations that we seek from Iran. I think the only way to do that, the only hope, is to promote a democratic transition in Iran. And to do so, you have to be very careful in doing that. It can't be the old Bush policy where you sort of give money to these discredited opposition groups that really make things worse. But it has to be a foreign policy that isn't done in conjunction with our allies, that has to have its goal supporting and facilitating a democratic transition. It has to be done by Iranians, and it has to be done very carefully. Because I think once you have a democratic transition, then you begin to see those changes that I think we want to see from Iran. Not a qualitative change, but you'll start to see Iran being brought into the community of nations, changing those aspects of its behavior that has been of such concern to the United States, particularly on the nuclear question. But I think the current policy is really a dead end street. It makes us feel like we're doing something, but it doesn't. In fact, it strengthens the regime. I mean, that's the reality. These sanctions have happened. And you know, this is not unique to Iran. I'm just not saying the sanctions that we have against Iran, you know, impoverished the middle class.
Cuba as well. 50 years.
Yeah, Cuba as well.
I mean, it's a primary case. Yeah.
So I think, but that, I think, in order for us to have that shift, you need a vision. You need leadership. You need someone to say, look, okay, you know, 30 years is a long time. Let's start to rethink this. But the electoral cycles that we have here in the United States, people don't have that long-term vision. You're thinking about the next election. You're thinking about, you know, a much more shorter time span. I think that's part of the problem with respect to U.S. policy toward Iran.
If there's no other questions, I wanted to follow up that question.
Yeah,
Mike. Because I was going to ask the same question you asked. And that is, could you put a little bit more meat on the bones of what a transformed or changed U.S. policy to encourage and aid in this journey for democracy?
It needs to, I think you have to sort of really engage in some new and courageous thinking. Let me just cite one example. Recall last month there were these two American hikers who found themselves, you know, on the wrong side of the Iran-Iraq border, and they were freed. One of the brothers of the hiker, Alex Vital, the brother of Josh, wrote this very interesting op-ed in foreignpolicy.com, where he came up with this argument. And he said, look, I've been involved in trying to get my brother's release. I've sort of become a mini Iran expert here over the last 2 years. And I think one of the things that the United States should do in order to sort of shake things up in Iran is to, you know, do something that they haven't considered before and actually press very strongly and seek ideas such as that, how do we increase further targeting of those officials that are involved in human rights violations, trying to isolate them, and also shining global spotlight. When Ahmadinejad comes to the United States, he loves to talk about two issues, because he wins on these issues back home. He loves to talk about nuclear weapons, and he loves to talk about Israel. What he doesn't want to talk about is human rights and democracy. When Fareed Zakaria was there 2 weeks ago, he sort of pressed him a little bit, you know. And then, you know, Ahmadinejad on the question of human rights was sort of put in this very difficult position. He had to say something that's really stupid that I think even the Iran and the ruling regime sort of found to be stupid. He had to say, when he was pushed on the question of human rights, we don't have political prisoners anymore. You know, and he asked, well, can I visit the Green Room leaders? Can I visit Nur Hussein Hussein? And then he said, oh, well, it's not really, he tried to, you know, he was struggling to sort of come up with an answer. He said, it's not up to me, we have a judiciary, the judiciary makes those decisions, I have no control over his president. And so these are the sort of the themes. And I think, you know, doing so is high time to do so, because now the region, the politics of the region shifted as a result of the Arab Spring toward the theme of democracy, toward the theme of exposing dictatorial regimes. And, you know, that's something that you already know before Karen Jean wants to talk about as human rights and democratic record, particularly the government of Iran, because it knows it will lose that debate, and it knows it's very vulnerable within Iran when this conversation